Brahms Piano Quartet No. 1 in G minor for piano, violin, viola, and cello. What can I say about Brahms? He had such a godfather-like presence in my music education because one of my influential mentors had Brahms' portrait hanging on the wall of her studio. That exact same portrait. Whatever you were discussing, be it music, life, love, or even food, whenever we would hit a crisis, she would always refer to his portrait and ask, half jokingly and half seriously, what do you think Brahms has to say about that? And I assure you, he had answers for everything. For a long time, that colored my view of Brahms as this font of unflappable and unerring sagacious wisdom. But when you listen to his music, the seething and barely contained passion is so evident that there must be more to that austere grandfather face. Brahms was a piano virtuoso and a prolific composer at a very young age. A study of his massive output would reveal that his music is very much influenced by the older masters, Bach, Mozart, and Beethoven. Yet, when he was introduced to Robert and Clara Schumann at the tender age of 20 years old, they were both so impressed with him that Schumann published an article in the leading musical journal of that day announcing that Brahms was fated to give expression to the times in the highest and most ideal manner. It was high praise indeed that would change the course of Brahms' life. For while Robert Schumann championed him and his works, Brahms, the young Brahms on the left, was also falling in love with Robert's wife, Clara, a woman 14 years older than him. So that's Brahms on the left, 20, Clara at 34, Robert at 44. When Robert finally succumbed to his insanity in the mental sanatorium in Bonn in 1856, it was Brahms who took care of business matters for Clara. For a time, Brahms moved in with her and her 8 children to help run the household. Everyone expected they would end up together now that the path was clear. But Brahms eventually moved away. To this day, there is much speculation whether they went beyond the platonic relationship. But Clara did write to their mutual friend, famed Hungarian violinist Joseph Joachim, that after her separation from Brahms, Clara confessed, "My heart bled." Yet, their friendship persisted, and the celebrated pianist herself, Clara continued to program and premiere several of Brahms' work, including this quartet we are about to hear. Premiered in 1861, this was the period where chamber music performance was transitioning from private homes into concert halls. Brahms rose to the occasion by expanding the piano quartet form, making this one almost symphonic in sound. The first movement is massive. A ruthless concentration on a one-bar motif that makes up the main theme. Let's have a listen. Would develop a whole first movement. Although other themes enter, the reckless expansiveness and unparalleled reshuffling of the exposition's elements in their recapitulation is overwhelming. There is a restless energy that continues to question its own premises. No comforting answer is found, and the all-consuming passion blazes out quietly in implied frustration. One can read all sorts of things into this movement, as Brahms never married. But the movement that will capture your senses is probably going to be the final movement, the exhilarating Gypsy Rondo. Their mutual friend violinist Joachim, who was Hungarian after all, praised this movement as an accurate imitation of Hungarian idioms. A virtuoso showpiece, the Gypsy-inspired music was a style that would serve Brahms well throughout his career. Let's hear a few bars of it. It almost makes you want to stand up and dance, right? Some with this appropriation of Brahms, of the Gypsy-inspired music, some would sneer and call this cultural appropriation. But I say there is no room for such boundaries in music. There are no superior cultures and no refugees. There is only a language that makes the blood pound, speaks to the heart, and ignites the soul. Rarely did Brahms write anything quite as viscerally exciting as the last few pages of this quartet. Perhaps he worked out his frustration in the end with a joyous shout, "Resist, persist, I too shall triumph over this."
Thank you. Thank you.